Hey, Vinyls Conversations. You're tuned into another Sunday with us. Welcome to the Vinyl Conversations group, the home of where we talk about what they were really talking about on those tracks, whether it's vinyl, CDs, 45, live streams, whatever it is, we're going to talk about it. So we are your hosts. I'm Latifa. That's Tamarisha over there. Say hi,
Hey,
Tamarisha.
y'all.
All right. Hope you guys are enjoying your Sunday again. So let's get all the particulars out the way, the disclaimer thing. We do not own the rights to any of this music. This is all for educational, entertainment purposes. That's it.
That's it.
At all.
At all. No, most
So for
not.
our social media peeps that, are out there watching, we don't own the rights to any of this stuff.
We do not own the rights to this music. It's for educational and entertainment purposes only. I feel like I gotta say that too, just in case they say we both didn't say it. So we
Right. So
said
you got it from both of us. Okay. We don't want any emails. Thank you.
it.
Right. Because y'all quick with those emails, real quick. But anyway, all right. So this is what we're going to do. We're just going to go ahead and get into the song. You know what we do? We play a little bit of the song, which is like the intro. So it doesn't alert the police, the social media police per se.
Right.
Right, that part. So if for some reason you hear muting, that's on their end. They do that if the song's played for a long period of time, but we try to get it under a minute. So let's get into the song. Let's welcome our
Oh,
guest to the group today, Eric Roberson. Thank you for joining us.
thank you for having me. How you doing?
We're good. How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. I had all my whole setup, and then all of a sudden the studio, a computer crashed. I was like, abandon ship. No Teddy Riley right now. Let's just go direct. Let's go direct. I had the whole thing set up. You see, look, it's all rebooting up now. It's like all rebooting up. I'm like, abandon ship. Forget. Look, I'm pushing microphones out the way. I'm like, just we here, we here, we here. Shout out to my brother Teddy Riley too, man. Shout out to him,
Nah,
man.
it's too late, sir. It's too
Of
late.
course.
It's too late.
It's all good. So all we do all we did was we introduced the song that we're going to talk about today, and of course we have you here, two-time Grammy nominated independent R&B soul producer, artist extraordinaire, Eric Robeson.
Oh man, I appreciate it.
Ooh, look at that title, that introduction, writer,
Hey,
all of it.
I'm ready to retire now. I'm good.
Retire? What?
After
You
that
can't do
intro,
that. See,
no, it's
everybody's
not.
like, wait a minute. I know they out there like retire. Like, okay, sir. My
Yeah,
pocket
no,
is my credit. Like, did you say you was gonna retire?
we not retiring no time soon, man. It's
That's
a
good. That's good to
blessing.
hear.
Yeah, you can't. What shows we gonna go to?
Right. Well, what show can we go to now anyway, right?
I
But
mean, you gotta
well,
think for the future. In the future. You know what I mean?
yeah.
You can do one of them, they doing concerts from their house now. Have you thought about doing that?
I had one last night. I had one.
Really?
I got one about every the show offers are still coming in different kind of ways, different organizations or whatever. I did a big Mother's Day thing where people had individual packages. I think we're doing a Father's Day one as well. So, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's crazy. We actually, in some form or fashion, I am technically busier now than I've ever been.
That's,
you know,
good,
yeah. So I can't say
it's COVID been nice to you, is what you're saying.
Yeah, I can't say nice, right? Because it's still a,
I mean, it sounds
situation.
Wrong, yeah. Life, but it's been okay, right? It's,
yeah,
been,
I mean, under the circumstances, right, it could be far worse. Like out of work, it, for me, it was more of like, okay, let's one finish up all the stuff that you had, you know, agreed to do, all the other work. And then I think it's just my peers, all of us are all waking up to our possibilities. So it ain't just music, but just our platforms in general. So
it's bringing out the creativity in everybody.
Everybody,
but if you have that creativity in you, it's showing right now. Not to say that we want COVID to be here. Like, it just sounds bad, but it did bring out the creativity in a lot of people. So
yeah, it did.
And also kind of like taking back your guys, your power in it. Like, you guys are controlling what you want to do right now.
You know, I think there's a time where you would worry about how it would affect your brand or just set up time and stuff like that. And you start realizing, even look at what D-Nice did and just how it exploded for him. And it came from, he had an idea, he had a feeling, he had a moment of service, and he got greatly rewarded for that act of service, right? So it's like, at the end of the day, you know, it's not a time for labels to be like, you know, record labels be like, hey, what you need to do is this and set up time. It's like, man, listen, first and foremost, people are home trying to get their minds off of stuff. So one, provide an outlet for that. And then at the same time, provide something for yourself, you know? So I do think that if you haven't seen it already, I think in the next couple of months, you'll have one of the biggest creative surges that we've ever received, especially with now, with the unfortunate situation I had with George Floyd, but the positive situation that came out of it. Of course, now us as artists, we've been the soundtrack to those kind of movements forever. So now it's the next challenge. Like, it's tough to sit down and write a love song right now with where your heart is at and where the world is at. So like, now the challenge is, if you've never written a political song before in your life, if you have never written a civil rights song ever in your life, this is the chance to try it. Right. You ain't got no manager to worry about. You ain't got no record label to worry about. You should worry about what the people need and what you need. So it's exciting time.
I agree with that. You're right.
Exactly.
I agree with that.
And look, we're here for it.
Yeah.
So kind of like what we did here with Vinyl Conversations, we started this in the beginning of the whole social distancing, us being in the house, and it was something for us being music lovers to divert the attention to something else, like to get our minds off of, you know, what everything that's going on outside. So that's what Vinyl Conversations is. And plus, you know, we wanted to dwell into these different genres, songs and lyrics of artists, like what was really going on when you wrote this song.
Gotcha.
So that's what we have today. We have Dealing. And Tamara's going to go ahead and go into the first segment of the lyrics.
And I'm going to go ahead and read, guys. And Kim, we are doing Eric Roberson, Dealing. So let's start out with the first verse. It says, where do we go from here? What do I do with these feelings? Longing to have you near. Knowing we shouldn't be dealing, why must the bad things always feel so good? Why can't I just stay away? Wow. Okay. Though our situation was understood, still does not mean it's okay. Where do we go from here? What do I do with these feelings? Longing to have you near, knowing we shouldn't be dealing. So
that's deep.
I'm gonna go ahead and go back because I had to stop, right? So why must the bad things always feel so good? So there's a lot of people out here that I know that can relate to that. Like, why do the all bad things always feel so good? When you were writing this, why did you put this in there? Like, is it something that you experienced personally? Like, bad things feel good. Why is that?
Well, I think one, God's a comedian, and what you're most weakest for and most weakest at, he's going to test you to get you stronger, right? It's the same reason why honey bun isn't a vegetable. You know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, you know, listen, imagine if Fruit Loops and Fruity Pebbles and Cinnamon Toast Crunch and Captain Crunch was vegetables, was as nutritious and healthy as broccoli. It unfortunately it's not, right? And that's life as well. You're gonna meet somebody who drives you absolutely crazy in both ways. And it's like, why did this person come in my life at this time? Or just enormously unhealthy for me, but I can't stop thinking that person.
That's why I was like, I can't stay away. Though our situation was understood, it doesn't mean it's okay. So what does it mean that your situation was understood? You guys were understanding that you were bad for each other, but you still move forward with it? Or
So the interesting thing I would say, I'm a songwriter, right? So So what I would tell you is that for me in writing songs, a lot of times I record most of the songs sitting right here where I'm sitting at right now. I don't usually write much down. This was probably the beginning of that point of where, for me, it's like trying to decide who I'm trying to be and then make the choices as from the character I develop, right? Now, mind you, I've been in that story millions of times. My college years, also, it's just a hot mess.
So you just forbidden fruit all around.
But the funny thing is also the song that's, you know, everybody looks at the song necessarily as a cheating song. It doesn't, right. At no point does the ever song ever mention you got this and I got, it never says it. It might exactly. Hit towards it. But at the same time, I wanted to make sure there was two things as a songwriter. There's a couple things I want to make as a songwriter. So one, the crazy thing was, with this whole album, if you listen to Music Fan First, a lot about that album is about infidelity and is also about not having things right. It was crazy that once I got married, I was able to write that album. It was something about like once I was secured with what I had, I could then unlock and write about my darkest fears, darkest secrets, as well as like what I observed as well. Because a lot of songs I wrote about my boys. But to get back to your question, to go back to why must the bad things always feel so good? Not only is that a life thing, but as a songwriter, if there is any songwriters here, to me, the most important thing is not just the hook. The hook has to have an impactful moment, impactful line. But your first line that you say, your first verse, that first line has to be fire. Because from that moment, I got to pull you in. From that moment, you got to go, I understand exactly what you're saying. So to start off, why must the bad things feel so good? We all understand that.
Right.
We all have somebody who we should never call again. We all have, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning.
Y'all do not call. Do not answer. Right.
You know, do not answer. You know, we've all been at IHOP after the club at 2 a.m. Waffle House. You know, we've all been there, and it's like that waffle tastes better at 4 o'clock in the morning. You know,
and then you go back and try to eat the same thing. Like, ooh, this is nasty.
It's nasty, but for some reason, it was really what I looked at as like a trigger line. It was a trigger line that actually holds some merit because we've all been there. We've all said this person is absolutely no good for me. They broke my heart 15,000 times, but they called me at the right time. My heart was a little soft. Before you know it, they over again, setting me up to destroy my heart again. You know, and so that was the part of that line. And mind you, though our situation was understood, that could be taken as anything. Just because
that was my next question. When it says thought our situation was understood, still doesn't mean it's okay. So you're saying that this is not a song about infidelity, but what does that mean when you're saying our situation was understood, still does not mean it's okay? What's not okay?
Well, it could be anything. Like I said, as a song, those two things that I was trying to do with this song. One, I wanted it to be a song of questions. If you listen to it, everything, why must the song good thing be so? The whole song is all questions except until you get to the bridge when the morning comes, right?
What do I do with the feelings? Yeah.
So what started me was saying, all right, what if I wrote a song with just questions, right? And of course, towards the end, we start getting into more stuff. But then I also wanted to leave it walking a line so that if you heard it, if it's your story, if you hear it, if it's just, you know, right. So if it is a thing where you're married and stepping out, or here's the ex-boyfriend who just, you know is no good, but for some reason you still keep him around. You know, it's whatever the situation is.
Right.
You know he hot trash. Y'all said we not going any further. This is a one night thing. I mean, you know it, right?
I'm sorry not to cut you off. Hold right. on, guys. I'm sorry. Somebody in the group wants to know what song. Guys, we are doing Eric Roberson's Dealing. This is
Eric Roberson's Dealing.
Dealing, guys. This is it. Eric Roberson's
Dealing. Yeah, I sent it to him.
Oh, okay.
Oh, you know, I'm just now seeing the cop. Oh, we're on it popping. Drunk Waffle House is way better than Sober Waffle House. And I don't even drink, but I know what you mean. I know exactly what you mean. So, you know what? Whether that's yo, I got a girl, you got a boyfriend, but let's still meet up, or that's
right.
Yeah.
Okay, we're not in a committed relationship, but I really want to see you tonight. Whatever the situation is, our situation is understood, right. But still doesn't mean that later on we're not hurting. Later on we're not going, well, what is this? What, you know?
Because you can still be friends. Like, it could have been a friend situation to where
completely,
you know, you're a toxic friend.
Complete. Y'all are friends. And she, for whoever the story is, she's someone I'm someone that she leans on to help get over heartache. And I know I'm that friend, but don't mean it. It's all right. I mean, I'm still not like, dang, I'm in the friend zone. I'm herbed out. I agreed to it. I opened the door. You know what I mean? Whatever. So I didn't want to get it so specific. Clearly, I could have wrote, you know, like a Shirley Marty, good morning, you know, and, you know, I would never, ever want to hurt her. I could have got it really direct, right?
Keep going.
But I was like, what if we walked that line? What if we walked that line?
Yeah,
and I had this pastor once come to me. He said, man, I'm a big fan. He said, man, I usually don't listen to songs about infidelity, but that Dealing song. And I said, but it doesn't have to be about infidelity.
You leave it. It's one of those from what I'm hearing from you and what the lyrics are. You're leaving it open for interpretation for whoever's, whatever you're dealing with, which is why it's called Dealing. So
it's
open for interpretation. Like, it could be infidelity. It could be your friends, like she said. It could be, you know, your ex. It could be shit. Sometimes it's your kids. Like, why am I dealing with you still?
At the end of the day,
Something abusive, like, or an abusive relationship or something, and you still dealing with it. So the title is perfect.
Preach.
It's dealing, and it could be anything, like you said. But you know, I think, as a generation, we're so used to the songs being about infidelity that we don't see past that. You know what I mean? Like, all these songs, like, when you see something called Dealing, it says, you know, I thought our situation was understood. It's like, oh, so they know they had somebody at home. Like, that's just our instant thought process. But
that also comes from us, you know, not being able to dwell into the lyrics and, asking these questions.
That part.
So well, this song is set up, and it's funny you say that, because the song is set up because it's questions and because it's vague, everyone can take it and make it personal into their own story. It's not detailed. I have songs where I've written as super detailed, and you know exactly what I'm talking about, where I'm going. But to a certain way, this record was vague enough where if that makes you think about your fourth grade sweetheart, if that makes you think about the drug dealing boyfriend who was really sweet, you know, you weren't supposed to be in the car with him. You know what I mean? And you was headed to college.
Right.
And you're like, oh my God. Please God, don't let me get pulled over.
Pulled over by the police. Why
you know, you know what I mean? It's like, why keep dealing? You told me we was just going to the movies. I know you had to be drunk. Oh my God. Good Lord, just get me pull over. Let me out walk. You know, it's like whatever your situation is. I'm just writing enough trigger lines in there to make you drift off.
All right. Let's go into verse two, guys, because he about to make me crack up too much. why can't these memories just be erased? Why must I yearn for your kiss? The first moment we're not face to face reminds me how much you're missed. Where do we go? Where do we go from here? What do I do with these feelings? Longing to have you near. Knowing we shouldn't be dealing, when the morning comes, when it's time for us to go our separate ways, when the night is done, I'll be wanting to hold on to you. Oh, the sun, I wish I could push it all away. because then we'll know that we can show what we have from the day. So, so when it says, why can't these memories be erased? Why must I yearn for your kiss? The first moment we're not face to face reminds me of how much you're missed. So that's another part of dealing, right? The memories, because you always, so memories can be deceptive, right? Sometimes we remember the bad, sometimes we remember the good, and sometimes we remember both. And when I see this about dealing, it says the memories can't be erased. Most of the time you're thinking about those good times and trying to push the bad ones back. Of and course. Then when right. you deal with that person, you realize, like, damn, that's why I wasn't dealing with you. Right. Like you exactly. got that memory because you pushed it back. And then when it comes full circle, you're like, damn, that's why I wasn't dealing
that,
with you.
I remember it. You ever noticed that when you're using memory, the part that you're thinking about is how you feel. It's not like this person, I hate this person, but I'm thinking about the good part. If you hate the person, you're thinking about the bad part. But if you can forget about how much you hate it or the fire that person made, that argument you had, when you think of the good time, you're back to the good feeling, you know? And then what happens is now y'all back on the phone or back, y'all done met up at IHOP 4 o'clock in the morning. And then there's a chance that bad hate part. Right. I'm just hungry. I'm on this keto diet, so I'm just yearning for pancakes and waffles. But maybe that's, maybe that's what, so it's really just that trigger. How do you get back on the phone? You get back on the phone because something comes across the TV, some song comes on, you go, oh yeah, I mean, we was in a car when that was on.
It's the memories.
Nostalgia.
It's the way you felt. It's that feel good. It's the feel good.
Yeah.
So it's like a drug in a sense.
Of course.
Those memories are what keep you hooked. And it is what keeps you hooked because, like I said, the memories can be tricky because you start to remember the good times and how you feel. And that overwhelms and you start to push the bad things to the back. Until that moment, you're like, okay. So, and you always thinking, it's always that I'm going to give this person another chance. Let me see what's going to happen. I'm going to give this person another chance. Then you give them another chance. You're like, that's why, because you did the same shit last
time. That's why. Thank you for reminding me. Right. But then you go away, you're missing them again. It's that tough wrestling match, and maturity comes when you realize, like, all right, I know better, no matter what.
When the morning comes, when it's time for us to go our separate ways, when the night is done, like, that's when you like, okay, it's over now. But I dealt with this now after this, not only were you dealing with this person, now you got to deal with the aftermath of your decision.
Interesting. This line, we move away from questions and we get more into the detail of the story. When the morning comes and it's time for us to go our separate ways. Right. So now we're getting a little bit more in detail, but it still doesn't mention anything of infidelity. But mind you, it walks that line of saying that when the light shines, we're not supposed to be together. Right. So you can take it for whatever you want. And then at the end of it, it's yearning. So we could show what we hide in the day. Right. So the last line of that bridge, which goes back to showing that there's still this tug of war. Like, how many times have we been in a tug of war with love? Like,
it's a cycle.
It's a cycle. And so it's bringing everything to a full circle in the bridge where, like, now the light shines.
Somebody said they got a keto recipe for pancakes.
Let me tell you. I already got them. Let me tell you. We can have a whole... I went through a storm. If I show you my cabinet of just so many keto recipes... I'm not a fan of coconut flour. I'm sorry. We're going to get back to this. I got just keto.
No, go ahead.
There's keto pancake mix that doesn't have coconut flour. Because what happens is when you cook the coconut flour, it actually cooks up to almost be like coconut. Yeah, I can't do it. Can't even do it.
So little pieces. Is what you're saying?
Yeah,
it just makes it taste like coconut. It just tastes like coconut.
Yeah, but I got some non-coconut. Yo, real talk, there's even keto bread now. That's like 3 grams of carbs a slice. I mean, it's completely cheating now. Like, it's
you want the pancake cassava flour.
You put the right oil in, you cook it with love, get them crispy edges, you're gonna still be all right. It ain't gonna be Aunt Jemima buttermilk, but You're gonna be all right. Back to this. Look at y'all. Look at y'all. Y'all better stop. I told y'all.
We plan for off task. That's why it's an hour, because we always get off task. Like, you all right. We still moving along.
It's all good.
No, it's all good.
Let's just do it. Somebody said I was gonna ask, is infidelity even an issue on this song? Is it two people who just ain't helping each other? And then somebody said, I need that hat. Is that one of DL's?
This is not one of DL's. Shout out to my boy DL Hughie. God bless him. That's my brother.
Somebody said they about to fake. They cheesing so hard, they face hurt.
Don't cheese. Go ahead. Listen, cash at me. What I'll tell you is that this hat probably cost me like 100, 150. But what I did was I went and personalized it. So I went and bought material from like Joanne's Fabric That's Star. Awesome. I did my own headband.
So you selling those, right?
I customized it. So then that's I put on like it's a rose. Then it's for Autism Speaks. So I'm doing it, and that's breast cancer, mm-hmm. and that's the DJ thing. And then I'm putting like safety pins in it.
Would y'all buy this? Would y'all buy these hats?
Holla at your boy. You know what I mean? I don't know. I'm just having fun. So that's what I mean. I got so many hats.
Yeah.
So you just kind of start, you know, get some scissors, cut it up, and just have some fun.
Somebody said it's cheating, like Dwelle said. I'm cheating on my girl with my girl.
Well, that's a different situation. That's called let's get a wig.
Yeah, that's different.
Let's get a wig. We've been quarantined in this house. I'll meet you in the living room.
I need to see other people. She's like, I got you.
Tonight I'm Jerome. Tonight, you know. That's what that is. We're gonna switch it up like Lil' Kim video, like Crush on Your video. I need you in a green wig tonight, you know, with pasties on.
Not a green wig, with pasties though.
Listen,
look that part.
Your name is Kwanzaa tonight, girl.
Somebody said, "Hold on, you said that Joanne." Yes.
Love it. Love it.
I tell you, some regular people store. People like, oh, you shop at Joanne, so you just go out in public. Oh, okay, he regular.
Whatever. I mean, if I need to find some pins, shout out to James, definitely F Cancer. But yeah, I mean, wherever I'm at, I like to pick up pins or like to pick up whatever. And then if I could customize it, so I might, you know, I think DL is probably doing. That's how he even branched off into his stuff. I think he might have put a toothpick. I got where's it? Is it right here? It should be right in reach. Hold on, let me see. I'm coming off camera for 1 second. I'm just seeing if something's on top.
Somebody talking about that could be our first date. He's married. We already discovered that. Whoever said that, there's no first date.
I am happily married.
Right. That part.
And I've got my wife pregnant multiple times. I'm completely locked in. I'm completely locked in now.
Somebody talking about edible panties. Like, y'all is not right. What's going on here?
Good. At all. They out of control. They out of control in there.
Right. Hey, let's do it, though. That's what it's all about. But, yeah, the song, that part is really coming into, you know, it that could just be very easy as, you know, let's say your friends have said, yo, that person is no good for you. And
yeah.
So now you can't bring them around your friends. So now when the day comes, they're like, what you been doing? Nothing. You know what I mean? you was with high trash.
You was out there doing the you was out there eating the forbidden fruit. Yeah.
Come on now. Come on, papaya. You know, the Bible never said apple. Did it ever say apple? Apple has got a real bad rap. It's amazing how apple has overcome. They still have apple pie and apple juice at the bad rap.
I think it's apple because people could see, like, apple has a seed in the middle, so you can see yourself biting it, and it actually a worm in the middle. It's like that was a normal fruit. Like, that's one of the first fruits of all time. Like, papaya was not one of the first fruits that we knew about.
It's mad seeds.
You don't buy the orange. You don't buy the orange. So it could have
been. It could have been a cherry. Choked on his spit. You got to buy a cherry because it could have got a fruit in the middle.
What kind of worm is it? An inchworm? Like.
Back then, cherries might have been the size of grapefruits. Like, everybody trying to hold things in detail. You've had thousands of years for things to change. You know what I mean? I'm just saying people need to be more considerate.
The cherry ain't changed, though. It's still small. The cherry is still small, though. The cherry ain't changed. It's still
small. You said still as if you knew what size a cherry was back then. A cherry might have been built for like dinosaurs back then. A cherry
Right.
Over time, genetically enhanced into this little bitty thing.
Once the asteroid hit the Earth and it was clogged up for multiple years and it didn't have sunlight, the cherry started to shrink. How you think grapes
are?
They were.
Raisins is
insane. I'm wild right now. Conspiracy theory.
You take it too far.
Like, my petition. My petition. We need to stop bad mouthing apples, man. It never said anything about apples.
Listen, it's believable that you can bite into an apple and a worm come out. You can bite into a peach, but have you bit into a peach? That shit hard. Damn, you break your teeth.
No, when it's right.
Then you bite into the wrong peach.
That's what I'm saying. So let me say this.
Not a peach, not a plum.
If forbidden fruit was a peach on a tree, could you imagine how ripe and soft and amazing that peach was? And she like, Adam, come bite this peach. And he like, and they all said it dripping down her arm. And he like,
that's why it wasn't.
We ain't supposed to be dealing with this tree.
Let me get a bite.
I mean, I'm saying the cherry theory. Thank you. The peach theory. It could be any one of these theories.
The apple is a sweet fruit, but the seeds are poison. How you figure the seeds? Have you ever followed?
I don't trust anybody who comment just as Facebook user. Put your name down there. You can't be talking reckless like that just under Facebook user. Your name, your comment is disqualified from the gate.
Somebody asked how we've been smoking. Only name I can see is James Williams. I can't see nobody else's name. They are all Facebook users to me.
It's all good.
That's only because they didn't accept it. But that was Natalie who said that about the apple.
God bless you, Natalie. No. God bless you. Don't get excited now. You late with that one. You were coming at like we've been done talking about the dripping down the arm. It's like, don't get X-rated now. We started preaching now.
Right. See, get your mind out the gutter. You're talking to Aaron Robinson.
Okay, so we're in segment two of the lyrics, but we definitely gotta give a shout out to Layla Hathaway. So how did that happen? How did you get her on the track?
So we were doing I think it's a there was this event called My Black is Beautiful. And I want to say it was in Chicago, and we weren't even there to sing. We were there to speak on a panel. And I had known Layla for probably a couple of years at that point. I was a huge fan, obviously. And then we were getting to become pretty good friends, which was like a dream come true for me because I was such a huge fan. And like I would usually fan out every time I see her.
That's awesome.
But around this time, we it was funny because weren't performing. We were sitting around. While we're just talking, and she's talking about music, this, that, and I said, yo, real talk, I just wrote this song that I could hear you on, you know? She was like, well, all right, send it to me. And I was like, all right, cool. And it was as simple as that. You know, I live in New Jersey. She lives in California. And I mailed her the idea. And the rest was history. It was funny because we were going to Skype. You know, at that point, technology was just getting to the point where we could kind of do this kind of stuff. We were going to like Skype each other into the call, but her first take, her first stab at it was what you hear, and it was perfect. It was perfect.
That's awesome.
You know, it's crazy. I'm struggling to remember the producer's name. Maybe if somebody look up the credits, type it in the comments because my name is escaping me. But the producer has since retired from music. That's why his name escaped me. But what I was saying was we actually had an idea. And then once me and Layla cut the song, most people don't know this, which is interesting. He called me and said, hey, I think I want to sell this track. I think it was Jill. He said, Jill Scott is interested in this track. I want to give this track to her. He's like, but yo, I can like redo music and like also make it like if this is going to be a single for you, I want to make it more like radio for you. And I was like, all right, well, cool. I'm not tripping, you know, whatever. And so the version that you hear is the redone version, but there was an original version. I don't think Jill ended up using the track either. So there's an original version. And it's funny because for the 10th anniversary, which was last year, I was going to release the original version. But when I finally tracked down the producer, It was just too much to try to get it all approved and stuff like that. So we just kind of went went past it, because it wasn't like the biggest deal, and it wasn't the biggest change as everything, but dude was like far more. He found God and not like a full time pastor now. I don't even think he plays music anymore. You know, I don't think because of that song. I think because it just in general. God bless him. I think, you know, everybody.
This dealing period.
Right. He said, "Why must that feel so good? No more honey buns as vegetables. I'm going.
No more apples.
See, look at Jay. Good, no more apples. Peaches. No more peaches.
No. Oh, you know,
no. Don't bring no peach cobbler over here." So he found his true message, and so at that point I was like, you know, I'm not even gonna really even bother you with like a ton of music business stuff, because that's not where his heart mind was at, and right. And stuff like that. But cool. The song was a great, you know, and she sent it, and when she sent it, just being the exceptional vocalist she is, I used everything she sent. I didn't call back and have her change one thing. You know, it was like
that's awesome.
That's talent. Okay, yeah. So third verse, last one, guys. Let's see what everybody in here talking about. They love you, Eric.
I love you too.
So where do we go from here? I need to know. What do I do with these feelings? Longing to have you near, knowing we shouldn't be dealing. I need to know, where do we go? I know I should walk away. Something keeps telling me one more day. See? Nope. Maybe if I'm patient, then one day it would change. Yeah, I'll wake up in the morning and it will not be the same. Everything is different. We just play the simple game. So,
yeah.
When it says I know I should walk away, something keeps telling me one more day, and it say one more, not more. My bad.
Yeah,
one
yeah,
more day.
Yeah. No, let's go. One more day.
Maybe if I'm patient, then that one day it will change. So in this sentence, this is when you realize that you're dealing with this person and you've seen the same characteristics that you saw. And part of you is hoping that you're going to wake up and that person is going to be the person you want them to be. And then
yeah, I mean, so one thing that I want to make sure to clarify, you know, there's a difference in one more day and one more day. That it's a mm-hmm. different time span. You know, mm-hmm. it's a different way to affect. So I'm always trying to go for one more day and mm-hmm. hopefully change. But if they're hot trash, more than likely they're going to stay hot trash. And it just comes time that you realize that you find it out and you find what's best for you. You know, that's what somebody in the comments said, how do you heal from those feelings? And I think for me.
And that was Sasha.
What's up, Sasha? And how do I suggest others to do that? One, I've been very fortunate to be a songwriter. And one thing that as a songwriter, I have a release for how I'm feeling. If you so choose to take whatever you feel, my wife knows that if we have an argument, there's a song going to come out of it. If we have a great date night, a song's going to come out of it. So everything in my life transforms into a song in some form or fashion. It's become my journals, you know. So I would tell you, you don't have to be a songwriter to release those feelings. One of the greatest things you could do if you have unanswered stuff with a loved one or with a person, I would write them a letter.
As soon as
I'm done writing it, I would just throw it in the garbage. As a matter of fact, I would literally put it in an envelope, seal it up, and then just drop it in the trash. But guess what happened? It's out of your system.
You got it out.
You don't have to tell them that. You don't ever have to call them and go, let me tell you something, Mr. Hot Trash. You don't have to go any of that stuff, you know.
Mr. Hot Trash.
You know, it might just be just getting it. But, you know, listen, I'm reformed hot trash, so you can change. and mind you, somebody's hot trash is another person's hot garbage. You got to remember that. So you can develop. It doesn't mean you don't always have to stay. Like that person was not a good fit for you.
What's the difference between hot trash and hot garbage?
Hot trash is like, you know, garbage is can be recycled and you know it can be used for other stuff. This is more of like, you know, if it didn't work with this person, the chemistry didn't work, or that person wasn't in a good time, they were really struggling. But literally keep it 100. How many people do you know Now, let me word it this way, because that's how many people you know in Mr. one situation was a horrible boyfriend or girlfriend, but in the next situation, they were a perfect boyfriend or girlfriend. You know what I mean?
It's like, right. But that's because of the lesson. You learn lessons from each other.
But is it the lesson, or is it just also the right place? I would tell you, like, keeping it 100. Most musicians, if I'm speaking for musicians, and I speak for male musicians because I'm not a female musician, so they might be the same way. A male musician is going to struggle in a relationship till they feel like they can take care of the relationship through their music. They're going to wrestle.
Sorry, repeat that.
I'll repeat it. So here I make music, right?
Mm-hmm.
But yet it's up and down. And I want to make sure I can take care of my family, take care of my girl, take care of whatever, right?
Mm-hmm.
So even if I find the best thing in the world, I'm still a little hesitant because I'm not in the right place where I'm at musically. I'm in a place where I'm afraid that you might tell me, yo, I got to stop doing music, go get a job because it's not working, or that it's not consistent or whatever. The more, for me, even speaking how I am, I knew my wife when my music wasn't consistently, because it wasn't consistent. And then as it got consistent, I could really present and I was presenting an all right guy to her, but I could really present the person I wanted to be and give her what I wanted once I knew this was working out. Once I knew that she couldn't be like, I mean, it sounds good, but when the last time you got a check? You know what I mean? It's like, because we want to provide. We want to make sure we're taking care of our situation. So I say that to say, how I handle a situation when my foundation is unsure is different than how I find it, handle a situation when my foundation is solid. Same way as my understanding with God or understanding marriage or whatever. So sure, it might be a lesson like, wow, this person broke my heart, or I did wrong with that person and I learned my better way. That's for some, but sometimes it just comes down to timing. You know, I'm right. In a great place mentally and health-wise. And then if I'm really going to really preach, if you know, come on, it's Sunday, amen. I ain't got this pink shirt on.
No, go ahead.
Once you agree to marry somebody, right? Once I'm like, all right, we going through this. From that point, now what it is I've agreed to be with you through your hot trash moments and through your hot garbage moments. Because right. I can't think that just because I married you, this music thing is always going to stay solid, or just I'm always going to be mentally healthy. I'm always going to be whatever. You always going to be whatever. What it is we're agreeing that saying through thick or thin, I caught you at a right time where I see your clarity. I see your heart. I see your effort. That's cool. And 5 months from now, I may have a sickness and don't have the strength to love you right. You right. Literally might be wiping my butt. In that moment, I need you to, you know what I mean? Or vice versa. So, you know, hot trash could be any level or whatever. I'm not going to be that exceptional person for you all the time. Doesn't mean
you're not going to be a honeybone all the time.
You're not going to be. You can't be. You can't be. But marriage is really saying, yo, I'm signing up to accept whatever you bring to the table that day, as long as it's effort. Our marriage counselor, who was amazing, God bless this woman. She said, it's never going to be 50-50. If it's a marriage, it's a pie. The best you may get is 51-49, but it's never going to be 50-50. There's going to be some days where it's going to be 80-20. Some days it's going to be 60-40.
Those are facts.
But you can't be sitting around going, well, you 40% today. You 40% today.
Those are facts.
And
but as the other person, you have to know that that's today this person is only giving 40, so I got to do 60, and you can't bring it up. You just got to get your 60, because one day you're going to be the 40,
right?
Ladies and gentlemen,
since we preaching,
there's some days you're going to be 10%,
and some days that 90%,
and that day that you 90%, you can't be like, yo, I'm 90% up in this. No,
right. You can't bring it up. You just got to do your 90 and humble yourself and move along.
Yeah, you know,
because one day you're going to be 10% and you expect that other person to just do their 90 and move along.
Justin, you know, we've been in a house for months now, and that can add effect to you financially. When a parent or a loved one passes, that you those days you're not going to be the majority of that percentage. So whatever, it doesn't have to always be something extreme. It's just the natural ebb and flow of stuff. So if I'm betting from this point on for the rest of my life, will I be hot trash at some point? Will I say something inappropriate to my wife that I, because I was hurt or upset or frustrated? It might happen. It might happen. Will I have to say sorry, whatever? It does mean I'm in the club going, don't stop, get it. You know what I mean? I mean, it can be whatever. So hot trash is definable to whatever your situation is. And thank God, I got a lockdown. She can't leave now. So
now you got a lockdown. We're not even going to get into that. That's a whole other show.
I possibly can so that she don't want to leave.
That's also part of growth.
It's also part of growth.
Yeah.
So it's like whatever, where you're at, it's also part of growth because people continue to grow.
Completely. Completely.
So you have to understand
completely.
That.
Completely. I mean, like I said, I know I'm jumping. I know this has nothing to do with dealing, but I realized a long time ago that who my wife was 10 years ago, she's not now. And who she going to be in 10 years from now,
she's not now. So, it ain't even years. It could be a week ago.
Yeah.
It could be a month ago.
When the pandemic started, she's a different person now. Mm-hmm. So what you have to do is I'm agreeing that I'm going to take a minute to learn who you are. I'm gonna take a minute to fall in love with the new things, right? To the new aspects, and I think that's why when you ask an old person like, "What kept y'all together?" I mean, sure, love is important, but more times than not, they're gonna go respect, honesty, effort. That's the stuff.
Guy said the difference between hot trash and hot garbage is juicier. I'm not playing with it. It's with you, James. Get on.
Nah. James.
You know when you pick that garbage bag up and it's leaking, he like,
on your floor. Juicier garbage is not okay.
That was that garlic shrimp. That's some shit up on that bag. And it's like funky, but still a good meal. You're like, it stink, but that was a good meal.
All right, let's get
But look, this right here, I mean, even though we're talking about the song Dealing, but the newness. That song there, that kind of intertwines with this here too, because in the beginning of the whole relationship and all that stuff, everything's new and it's fun.
Completely.
So it's like, what happens
with a hot trash ass?
You at that point, hot trash smell good. You like, ooh.
Yes. What is that? Is that 2 days
old? Is that bag leaking? Oh, that's what I'm talking about. I didn't know you was hot garbage. Oh, that's what I'm talking about. We
leaking with peaches. Wait, hold up. It's a song. Eric, it's a song right here. It's called Hot Trash.
Hot Trash.
The remix is peaches.
Hot trash. I love it. And the remix is peaches. The peaches
hot
remix.
Hot trash, but garbage is juicy.
Let's go. I thought you was hot trash. I love it.
Girl, but you smell like peaches right now. Ooh,
but yeah, but the newness is we know we all fall victim to that. It's all, we want to bring out our best, and we have to, the best thing that you learn in relationships is that stuff dies down a little bit. You be careful, willing to accept that in 6 months or in a year from now, if she wrote you a letter every Saturday, or if he cooked you breakfast every morning, that the breakfast was slow down a little bit, or that the letters might slow down a little bit. And that's just natural. It's not a fault. Nobody's.
Right.
I think a lot of times, and I know a lot of my friends who are like, she tricked me into thinking. And I was like, I don't think she tricked you into thinking. I think she really liked you. So she was bringing out all this different stuff.
Don't start preaching on here, sir.
But we human.
Got 11 minutes now.
I know, but I mean, right. Look, but we don't. Come on now.
Somebody said the whole album is a story.
The whole album is a story. Yeah. And really, Music Fan First, like I said, that was the album where I was like, okay, I can't just write about myself. I can't write about my stories. What's going on with that person? So I was really like pulling from different people as well. And so it touched on a lot of different subjects, a lot of tough subjects, but it was real, stuff that I've been through and we all can relate to.
Somebody said that they already was writing the lyrics to Hot Trash for us.
Let's go. Send it to me. I'll sing it.
All right. Let's go on back to let's take this time to talk about some things that you have done and things that you are going to do. So first I want to talk about some of the people you've written
for. You got a list.
So, because I've seen some of the things, some of the people that you wrote songs for. So do you still write for other people, or are you just solely like trying to do your own thing? Like what's happening with you right now?
I still write.
Because one of the people that you've written for was Carl Thomas, and we had him on 2 weeks ago.
Got you. Funny enough, you know, Carl Thomas is working on an album right now, and I've already written two songs for the album.
The Pet album.
He came in here and he dropped the bomb on us about I Wish, and it was like he said this song was based in high school. We were like, high school.
Yeah, you'll be surprised. Well, I mean,
it was one of those things where we had that moment, like,
right? No, nope, you didn't know.
You know what I mean? You thinking that this is a grown up situation, like this lady, she had kids and this and that. He said high school. We all just kind of like, high school.
Everyone.
I'm not one bit surprised. I mean, you know, in high school, that's some of the juiciest breakups and mistakes we made. You know what I mean? If you can remember them, pull from that
song. Dripping all down your arm.
Come on now. The first time I saw a girl eat a peach, I was like, word? You know what I mean? And it wasn't in college. That was like sophomore year or junior high. I was like, oh, okay. You know, we all look, it's Sunday. We all been in that church bus in the back with, you know, some of y'all were a little more heathens than I was. But no, when you discovered,
you know about the back, you was in the back.
You know, and so if somebody eating a peach, you looking, you like, I never saw it this way, but now I'm like, oh, I see the importance of who you are now. And then you found that little liquid dripping down her elbow, and I went swimming.
You'd be like going home, like, Mom, I'm going to Bible study next Monday.
Right, right. Bible study popping. Your mom like, I'm so proud of you going to Bible study. As long as that bus keep picking me up, I'm going.
Look, and you gotta bring peaches.
Mom, can you make some peach cobbler? No, just the peaches. I'm bringing peaches with me. Peaches. You know,
what else are you working on though? Okay, besides you working, getting those two songs out there, what else are you working on right now?
Man, you know, I just put an album out. So when the whole pandemic started, I made an album called Hear From Here, and then I have a group called The Process. Shout out to anybody in here who's part of The Process. And what that is, people subscribe to follow me in the studio. So every song I do, they get a copy of and they get a chance to see. So like while I'm working on Carl Thomas, they see, okay, Carl Thomas hit me up, watch this. And then they can see if those songs work or don't work or whatever. And then they actually A&R my albums. Like, this is the way I'm gonna make my music from now on. I'm gonna make it in front of them. And right now it's 550 people. It's great. And it's a weekly podcast, so it's really grown into a great community. So that's one of my focuses. And of course, within that, I did three songs on Avery Sunshine's last album. Of course, we're starting now to work on a new album now. And offhand, my mind is escaping me. I know me and Kanye Dawson are doing stuff.
Talk about these concerts that you were doing. Where can people watch these? Like, because you said that you guys might do one for Father's Day. So where can those be like seen and viewed? Like,
The Father's Day one is with City Wineries. They're doing those we'll start advertising, I think, because Father's Day is in a couple of weeks. So you'll probably start seeing that this week. And then
someone wants to know how they can join The Process.
Go to jointheprocess.com. Jointheprocess.com. And you can
we'll post it in the comments.
Yeah, and I do live shows there. I do live shows on there.
Do you do Instagram yet?
Yeah, I've done when everything first started up. Oh my God, I was on Instagram doing shows like every other day at one point. And I'll probably still do one real soon. What I've been tugging at lately is I have an album called Fire that we did 3 years ago that really touches on a lot of stuff that we're dealing right now. And I feel I've just been really compelled to say, I think I'm just unannounced one day, just go on live and just sing the whole album down live. Just,
that'd be dope.
That would be awesome.
Yeah. You know, there's a song on there about Tamir Rice, the 12-year-old mm-hmm. who's killed in the park by the police. Mm-hmm. And I always say it's probably the most important song I've ever written. And it wasn't written like so I could blow up and then like that. It just was a story that like somehow the world was fine with a 12-year-old playing with a toy in a park, and the cops came and shot him. And we were like, I thought half of America should have burnt down then. You know what I mean? Like, you know, and somehow we were outraged, but we kind of kept moving. So it was interesting because I think we often make songs where we try to help people escape. We try to make them go somewhere. Right. And this was probably the first time I realized I was writing a song so that you couldn't escape. It's like, right. I knew that you may only listen to this song one time, but for this one time, I'm going to punch you in your chest so hard so that we can address this idea. Right. You know, so I mean, I'm kind of, you know, I mean, I worked the record 3 years ago when it first came out, but it keeps tapping me on the shoulder now, like, yo.
And if it's telling you, you probably should.
You got to be releasing
it. Yeah, so we'll talk about that a little more. We'll talk about it a little more. And I mean, you know, I think it's needed. I think, you know, when you look at where we're at now in police brutality and how so many things are overlooked, I'm just happy that we're starting to have that conversation again on another scale that hopefully goes to solutions. Yeah. You know, if us musicians can apply any kind of effort to it that will help towards a solution, so be it. Count me in.
Yeah, I see a lot of that coming in. I hope that it really does come full frontal because, like you said, it's needed. And it's not one of them things where we all got to get away sometimes. But this is, like you said, one of them issues where you just got to be like, today. Like,
exactly.
Y'all kept poking the bear like.
Yeah.
You don't wake up? And then put everybody in the house, and then you know what? Let's poke this bear again.
Let's go.
And then they poke the bear. It's like, so you got everybody on lockdown. You're barely letting some of these people out in the streets, and then you go and poke the bear. Oh no, bear walk now. Hibernation over.
Work now. Let's go.
Right. Okay. So look. So I am a huge fan. So every time you came to Atlanta, we was at your show.
Perfect.
Some of my girls in the group, so they know. But I do have to ask this. How was it working with Fonte, little brother?
Fonte's little brother.
Fonte of little brother.
Right. Fonte is like is like my little bro as well. You know, I mean, it's, you know, the blessing of that is that we're friends first, you know what I mean? And I think you know, I've been a fan of his work. He's a fan of mine. And we talked for years of saying, it initially just started off like, all right, anytime I need him on a song, he hop on a song. Anytime he need me, I hop on a song. And it was years of that. And then we were like, we should do a group. We should do an album together. It just makes sense. People were asking for it for years. And then finally, it was funny because we had just had our third child. And I was in the hospital, like holding my son, like he was like born the day before that. And finally called me. He's like, all right, yo, let's start recording. I got a window. I got time. Like, let's record it now. And I'm like, I just had a baby. And like, he's like, all right, well, let me know if you can work it out. So, I mean, I cut 75% of the album holding my son. There's a line.
Antonio put us on to you. We were like, who is Eric Roberson? So we went to the concert and we were hooked after that.
Antonio put us on. Antonio? Who's Antonio? I love how they just mentioned Antonio. Like, oh, yeah, Antonio. I'm like,
yeah, you know him.
In Atlanta?
Shout out to Antonio. I appreciate it. Oh, man, can we talk about the track?
Shelly, Antonio's last name, ATL.
Can we talk about the track Pretty Girl on album Left?
Okay. Pretty Girl is shout out to James Poison and Jay Dilla who produced that track. James Poison gave me the track many, many years before. And it's just an important song. It's a song that probably took me a long time to write. To finish, shall I say, because I didn't want to get like super, super duper preachy, but it's really just letting somebody recognize, just really see how important and how beautiful you are, not just by what's on your face, but just in who you are, how you carry yourself, your heart, you know, yeah, everything. But yeah, what for those who on here, what's interesting, Pretty Girl was going to be a duet between me and Lewis Taylor. If any of y'all know who Lewis Taylor is, one of my favorite artists. But at the time, Jay Dilla was really, got really, really sick. And this was probably the moment where I was, you know, we're kind of all thinking that he might not make it. So I remember telling Lewis Taylor that I got to at least wait because I don't know what's going on. And unfortunately, he did pass like within the next year or so. He passed. And then Aunt Fiddler connected me with Jay Dilla's mom. And that's how we were able to work out the business stuff for the song that she worked on. But by the time I did that, Lewis Taylor was unreachable. I never could catch up with him. But it would have been.
That song got them through. They cried a lot listening to it. It helped them grow.
That was Sasha.
It's important song. It's an important song. I appreciate it, Sasha.
Picture Perfect.
Yeah, so you definitely can't retire. So that's definitely out of the question.
Right now. No, I'm not. I wouldn't want to retire. I'm good, man. My goal is to grow old doing this. If God will.
Grow old doing it. Right.
Oh yeah.
Okay, so look. So another thing. So Eric. So we actually have a mutual friend in common.
Who is that?
Okay, so back in college, I was a rep for Atlantic Records. And my boss that was there is your mutual friend, our mutual friend. He's a friend of yours. You guys are really close.
From Atlantic Records.
Yeah. And you guys went to Howard together.
Oh, wow. Okay. Which one? Because I know a ton of people from Atlantic Records. Oh, okay.
So Chris Washington.
Oh, yeah. Yes. the legendary.
The legendary. He's on his show right now.
So y'all did a little bit of hot trash together?
No. Listen.
Nah. Dang it, man. I'm trying to get it out of here.
Look, no dirt.
I was trying to follow Chris's footsteps, you know what I mean? So yeah, it was I can't say I did, nor did I see him do too much dirt. And even if I did, I'd never tell.
That's what's up. Keep them secrets your own.
Look, Chris is the party. Chris is the party.
is the party.
Oh, okay.
For real.
Yeah. He is the party. Yeah. That's good. Somebody said
HU as well. Shout out to HU up in the building.
Ooh, you like
definitely
Julia Pinky Johnson. I play that for my daughter. I'm sorry, I don't know if I'm saying that right. I don't know what that is. What that says. Is it Julia?
Oh, they're saying for a song.
Oh,
Picture Perfect.
Picture Perfect is important. Picture Perfect was a song I wrote for my wife when she was pregnant with our first son. It was like my gift to really just telling she looked perfect to me. Like, and no matter how uncomfortable she was, and she was going through a lot of pain and a lot of discomfort, but I was like, God couldn't make you look any better to me right now, you know. So I really tried to make that song.
Oh, that's cool.
As a thank you to her. It didn't make her feel better, but at the same time, I got a good song.
But how do you feel about it now, though? Like, of course, if she was pregnant, she got too much going on. You wrote a song, great.
Right. Right. Finish the song, take these kids. Lord, Jesus. You know.
Seriously, you made a song. That's awesome. But can you bring these kids into the world? Oh, okay, whatever.
All right, so where can they find your recent album at? Is it all on your website and all social media?
It's available. It's available everywhere. Of course, we did it in the pandemic, so we didn't make hard copies, no vinyl like that. But we will do it.
Oh.
You can go. It's on Apple, on Pandora, whatever, Spotify. But you also can go to ericrobersonmusic.com, and then at the same time, you can go to the process, join the process, and if you scroll down, you'll see video of me working on the songs. You'll see the first drafts of these songs. You'll see how it really grew. And like we've been doing for the last couple of albums, what I do is I'll record a whole bunch of stuff, and then the process members will vote what songs make the album and don't make
that
the album.
That is so dope.
So yeah, and there's a whole other album.
That's a really dope idea.
You know, about 4 or 5 years ago, we started as a private Facebook page. And it just was more like, you know, just showing more. You know, we're at a point now where nobody knows who does what. There's no more album credits and stuff like that. So I was like, why don't we show everybody everything?
Right.
So Right. My goal is really when I walk in the studio, you get a text message that says Eric's working, and you can plug in and, you know, and just watch. Now, mind you, it's quite boring because it takes a long time and whatever. But at the same time, there's little nuggets in there. And so what I do is I might video. I mean, I got literally cameras all around here and mics all around here. And then what I do is I might edit it down to like 15 minutes so that you see the main moments that made what you loved, you know. But it's that's just really it's a real cool thing.
It's like feedback, instant feedback, instead of waiting for your album to come out and people like, oh, I don't like that song. Like, he should have put this on. So now you get that instant feedback, and it's more fan based, which is who you're trying to entertain.
That's the best thing for me. Me personally, what the greatest part of the process from my side is that I find out early what works and what doesn't work. You almost find out immediately. If I post something at 2 o'clock in the morning, and then the next day everybody's talking about it, you know, you probably got a good one here. But if I post something and like only, oh, that's cool, yo, that's what's up. Okay, that song needs a little more work. You know what I mean? You just go by the reaction of what the song calls. So it kind of gives me a front center.
Or is that just you? Do you know of anybody else doing that, or is that just something that you do?
I mean, you know, we do a thing called Chasing Goosebumps with there's a thing called the Playlist Retreat DJ Jazzy Jeff has. And we live streamed the making of the first Chasing Goosebumps album, which was pretty incredible. And that was around the same time. What's my girl, bass player, singer? Oh my God. She made an album in 7 days, seven songs in 7 days. Esperanza Spalding. She did it and she live streamed that. Like, it was live streaming 24 hours a day. So even I think when they were sleeping, the engineers were working on it. So there's people who are kind of doing different stuff. Yeah, I mean, I think with technology opening up, people are just exploring more technology and how it can apply. So now when you look at it, when you go on IG Live at night now, there's producers who are sitting down. Michael Cox will sit down and work on a beat. Yeah. He'll put on IG Live and he'll just start working. So it's kind of the same thing. For me, it was like, how can we just build an organized group out of it? My goal is to get it to like 3,000 people in it, and it just be like completely self-sufficient, you know, bananas.
Right. So with that, does that coincide with how do you started this whole independent status? Cause you're still independent, right? Like, this is all your stuff. Okay.
I mean, everything comes down to, you know, I've always been independent. And even when we were, even it's funny, when I started as an independent artist, which was 20 years ago, we of course didn't have all these different things. What we did have was we had forums. So that's how I discovered that people in Japan were even listening to my music, and people in Italy or other countries were like even aware of who I was from these forums that were out. There was a forum called Soul 24/7, I think was the one that really like launched my career off, because hundreds of people were on there talking about the music I was releasing. And then I started my own forum. I remember Layla Hathaway had hers, and it was another way of like a community kind of thing. So it's almost kind of going back to that. But to me, if anything that this pandemic can also tell everybody is that equipment is power. And if you got your own equipment, you know, and building your platform, a lot of times you can. I was a songwriter producer before I ever released the album out. So when I was a songwriter producer, which I still am, sure, but the problem with that is there's ups and downs with it. It's like hot and cold. Why? Because I'm trying to make money on someone else's platform. If Arista Records has an artist and that artist doesn't come out, guess what? I don't make money. So the moment as an independent artist, I was like, okay, this is my platform. So whether it works sink or swim, I could at least have something come out of it. Cause I know as long as I put effort, put whatever, something's gonna come out. I might not make as much money as I would if I was working with Sony, but I know it'll be consistent. And if it fails, it fails on my dime. It fails on my watch. Right. And I think this is the same thing. I think, you know, if you have a mic, you can start a podcast. If you have a platform, you know, if you have this and that, if you have recording equipment, you can record all day. If you have keyboards, you can work on your sound. So I'm always challenging somebody to not wait for the opportunity, but yet build the opportunity, because the very platform that you build can be the next thing, you right. know, can be exactly. the next thing.
Right. I mean, you can be the next vinyl
conversation.
The next who?
Look, that part, the next vinyl conversation.
Right,
the
right.
Next us.
Right.
So we definitely appreciate, you know, appreciate you being on the show. One of the things that we're going to do too is once outside opens, you know, we will have like live shows, actual in-person live shows, and we will love to have you on one of them if that's possible.
That's cool.
I know we got to go through the channels and all, but you know,
let's name it and claim it. It was a great time talk. Y'all as silly as I am, which is always a beautiful thing. You know,
yeah, I had a great time. I hope that you had a great time with us too. I hope everything that you expected or more than what you expected when you got on here. I don't know if you did any research on what we did before you got here, but I hope that we surprised you and made it feel like I feel like we were just chatting with the homie. Like I feel like on this broadcast, and everybody loves you.
Everyone in the group is,
they don't care about us, they worry about you.
Well, I love him too, man. I really appreciate it.
We don't do much. We just got you here. You know?
Oh, just this little work, you know.
Just a small thing.
Change the whole face of mankind, and the apple gets all the credit. Look at that.
Now we got a hot press single coming out. You know what I mean?
With peaches.
Right. Listen, we need to start a new podcast called Hot Garbage.
We gonna make the peach tape.
Like, Let's go. Hey, listen, stop giving peaches so much credit. I'm just saying treat apples better. That's all I'm saying. It's like, you know, peach went by unscathed. Still.
How we going to give peaches not enough credit when you got it dripping down? And
Think about it this way. You know, going back to this, my final thing with this. Has apples ever looked sexy? No. Peaches is 3 o'clock in the morning Waffle House. So what would make you not think that
in a certain way you could cut the apples in a certain way? They can be wedges and they can look pretty nice.
Listen how you said it. Did that sound sexy? That ain't sound sexy at all. Cut it in certain wedges, they look pretty nice. But you seen somebody with that peach and they biting and it's all squishy and mushy and dripping out their arm. You like, see, that's what Adam was looking at her like. I was going to say no. But the way you, and don't let her start sucking on the peach and stuff like that.
Oh my gosh.
Adam was like, you know what? Listen, how bad can menstrual cramps be? Let's go. Give it to me. Let me get it. You know, so I think, you know, it's like cherries. Look, you know, you bite a cherry and a little bit of the red dribble. Apples ain't never do that. Apples ain't never make your mind go. But
you're going to this 112 peaches and cream.
Right. Can you pick up some peaches? All I'm saying is y'all need to read your Bible. That's really all I'm saying. Amen. Read your Bible and look at it differently. Look at it differently. Y'all are just immediately taking apples and running with it. Don't let people brainwash you. Don't put words in your mouth. Allow it to accept what the reading is there. Look at the layers. There's layers in this writing.
Eric Roberson said apples is not sexy. So that's not what the forbidden fruit was.
Mangoes. Well,
it's all about peaches.
Mangoes.
It's all about peaches. It's all about peaches and cream. 112.
See, look at that. See, I'm trying to keep this spiritual and you taking it to bad boy stuff. Listen, so no, it's all good.
Nah, we're going to make that hot trash single. Let's go. When we go live, that's what we're going to do. We're going to make hot trash on TV.
Yeah. Look, no. So on our way out, Eric, you know, you can go ahead and if you can bless us with a little something to segue on out of here.
We appreciate you. Everybody follow him. Join the process. All of that. His page, his social media, everything.
All the social media.
Let's get it.
A quick freestyle for y'all. I ain't got no music. Right. Up, no, so we just gonna have some fun.
Okay.
All we do might be a smash. We gonna talk a second about some hot trash or hot garbage, which one you prefer. But make sure you know when hot trash occurs. You might see it spread out all across the nation while we having this final conversation now. Peach juice running down your arm. I think you know who is the bomb now. This is F. Roberson signing off. I love my peaches cause they so soft from now. Apples ain't sexy, but I love them too. You can make apple pie, that is true. So don't you be Adam and don't be Eve. Tonight I just want you to receive this little tune from me to you. See you at the next podcast, final conversation coming. Peace out to you. Hallelujah.
Hey.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for that, Eric.
Out here, and we appreciate you so much.
Thank you. Y'all be safe. Right. Y'all be safe. We look forward to doing this in person.
All right.
Take care. All right.
Bye, guys.
Oh, yeah. That was fun.
That was awesome. We appreciate y'all watching and participating in this hour and 16-minute show. I hope everybody enjoyed it because I had a great time, you know. And we got
as usual. We had a hot trash, garbage, hot garbage, good time.
That's for real. It was a trashy good time all around.
The trashy good time. So definitely make sure you guys tune in for next week. We're not gonna even tell you who we got next week, but yeah, just make sure you tune in.
We're here for it. You already know it don't really matter who it is, it's gonna be an excellent show, but y'all gonna be like,
yeah,
what?
That part.
They doing a little
so bit make sure you way. Share, like, repeat.
All of
those
that.
Three. All of
we
that.
Love y'all.
Peace.
Bye. Thank you.